views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Hola, everyone. Welcome to Open, the one and only show bringing the best of the Bronx, New York, and the world straight to you. I'm Rina Valentin, your host de Café con Leche, every Friday. Here's what's coming up in today's show. Leading things off, we'll find out about an exhibit bringing together two visual artists inspired by their background in theater. After that, we'll learn about a three-day-long celebration for the king of Latin music, Tito Puente. And then we'll take a look at one photographer's work, which explores the cultural conversation between Africa and the West. And later on in the show, Bobby C. brings us up to date with the latest headlines in the world of sports. And finally, our open artist spotlight this week features the extraordinary choreography of Michio Tanaka, director of Mad Dance Company. So sit back y prepárate. All this and more is coming your way because now we are officially open. Welcome to Open. I'm Rina Valentin, your host de Café con Leche for the next hour. Always inviting you to get social with us online. That's right. Tweet us and follow us on Instagram at BronxNet TV and like us on Facebook at Open BronxNet Television. And of course, while you're there, don't forget, follow me on Twitter, Instagram, FB, Snapchat, Insta Stories, LinkedIn, at Rina Valentin. For the month of April, let's talk about the month of April. We're already in it. And so Gallery 18, located at the Riverdale Y, will showcase an exhibit featuring two artists who have roots in theater. And one artist is an impressionist painter and the second is a sculptor, both of whom use their passion for the arts to guide their creativity. And here to share more with us are Jane House and Orhan Alpaslan. Yes, I got it right. Yes. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Welcome, welcome. And thank you for, I guess, showing the importance of arts just being arts versus, I guess, being married to one genre of an art, right? Because they all feed each other.
Yes, I think so.
And as a thespian, as a fellow thespian, we can talk a little bit about how often did you visit museums or exhibits to feed your development?
Well, I can go.
Whomever was
I've been going to museums for all my whole life, and for these particular sculptures, which are aquatic, mythic themes that I've done in the last 2 years, I was particularly interested in bronzes. So I went to see bronzes and I wanted to make some of my sculptures look like bronze. That was the big thing. And then of course the facial features, the masks, you know, it's very wonderful to go to the Metropolitan Museum of Art and see masks and how the Greek sculptors did their faces. And so it's very important to go to museums to see that.
So you're really talking about like even the details. That's the beauty of living in New York is like you have access to all this fine art, right? But I was asking more along the lines of like in being in the theater realm, like before we even became visual artists, because you did mention to me that you been a visual artist, I guess officially a visual artist for the past 2 years, but I'm sure you've been a visual artist before that.
Well, I did always.
Oh, sculpting artist.
I did always paint as
Yes.
I am also going to museum always frequently, and then also my young time I went to European museum and. For example, France, Germany, and Netherlands. I researched there a lot of inspiration to me, and
Where are you originally from?
From Turkey.
From Turkey?
Yes.
No. The accent, and what's beautiful is that your work captures New York.
Yes, the New York, I entitled New York, my exhibit in Gallery 18, 26 painting there, about New York, New York life and seasonal image, Central Park, or some of the person watching each other.
Like right, this, we'll get the visual in a minute.
Yes.
We're actually going to show them to our viewers in a few, but I just wanted to familiarize myself with your process, and mostly because I was very fascinated with the fact that the title of the exhibit is Two Fine Artists with Roots in Theater.
Theater, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I must say that acting on stage is really quite different from having a piece of clay in front of you and manipulating it so that it creates something. And that's what I love with the clay, is that you let yourself go and you let your hands kind of do the walking. So I try not to plan too much how it's going to look. Which does have roots in theater in a way, because it's an improv.
Right.
You know, you allow yourself to just be and allow your hands to just be and do it. So that's connected to theater, but quite different. And another part of what is connected to theater is creating the masks. Because I think as an actor on stage, well, you certainly would have that experience, is you're aware of other people's faces.
Right.
So you love to create those faces and different expressions.
Thank you. Yeah, no, it's very, your work is beautiful. Can we show some of Jane's work?
Well, I think you have at least one piece there. It's a boy on a seahorse.
A boy on a seahorse? Oh, no, we have this.
Oh, and this is the woman, Thalassa was the Greek goddess of the oceans, the primeval goddess of the oceans, and I did her rising from the sea. I like the different texture of the human body against the sort of movement in the ocean.
And I noticed you like the ocean and the water and so.
Well, they're very important now. They're very important now. You know, the sea is something that we're destroying, and you know, you see images of also refugees in the sea. So the image of the image of the sea became very important for me too. To sculpt.
So let's share a little bit about the myth behind this sculpture.
Uh-oh. Well, this was a human boy who was one of the great gods found that his mother was, or the great god's wife actually found that his mother was doing something she didn't like, and so she drove the mother mad and she jumped into the sea, and she had a boy with her. But the other god saved the boy and made them both into made them both into gods, and the little boy became known as a boy who rescued sailors and people who were struck at sea. His name was Palamon. You know, I'm not going to spell that for you, but but he's usually seen on a dolphin.
Nice.
But I decided I loved the shape of the seahorse, and so I decided to do that. And then I glazed the seahorse to make it a shiny color, and I painted the boy.
It's beautiful. How long does something like that take to make?
A long time.
A long time.
Yeah.
It's very detailed, so I'm just curious.
Yeah, like I couldn't decide how to paint it. I did it very realistically, and then that didn't work. So I decided to do the glaze one thing, and then the painting another. I mean, the everything else another color, so it hung together better.
Nice, thank you.
And I must compliment to my teachers, Rochelle Arruti and Donna Diamond, who are both Bronx teachers of the arts.
Yeah, that looks like it requires a lot of patience. Orhan, right?
Yes.
Yes, let's talk a little bit about your paintings.
And, yes.
Especially being here in New York, having come from Turkey and dealing with snow.
This is snow for Manhattan, but full of emotion, you can see. Very emotion painting.
It almost looks like a portrait.
Impressionist painting,
yes,
also.
It's very nice.
It's in winter time.
And do we have any other images of Orhans?
And oh, this is also 4th of July.
Lovely. Anything else?
Autumn in Central Park.
Yes. That's amazing. Lovely, lovely.
And this is symbolic painting, colorful for about New York.
Well, congratulations to you both on your exhibit. Oh, we have another one. I didn't see this one before.
This one is Café Gorz.
Uh-huh.
Yes, but very emotional stage, I think. Like a stage, I am seeing it always like a stage, life.
Like a set, yeah, like, yes.
Yeah, you can see that.
Yes, emotion. Absolutely, yes.
There's a story going on.
Absolutely, including emotions.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's not just a portrait of someone.
Oil painting, all of them,
oil painting, very nice, thank you. So, congratulations to you both.
Thank
and
you.
How long are you on display for?
Till the end of this month, at least.
Yes, at the end of April.
At the end of April.
Yes.
Well, thank you both for being here with us.
Thank you everyone, so much.
Everyone should see.
Everyone should see, right? Especially if you're into theater, right?
Yes, absolutely.
I'm sure there's something for everybody to leave with. So thank you so much once again.
Thank you.
To Find Artists with Roots in Theater is on exhibit through the end of April at Gallery 18 at the Riverdale Y, located on 5625 Arlington Avenue in the Bronx. And for more information, visit riverdaley.com/community/gallery/18. All right, we have to take a quick break, but we'll be back with more Open after this.
Did you know kids who play outdoors have healthier lungs?
Totally.
I did. Did you know that boys that play with dolls make better husbands?
My son has lots of dolls. But did you know terry cloth diapers breathe better?
I did.
Mm-hmm. It's totally true.
Oh, yeah.
Did you know that strollers have the right of way on the sidewalk?
Yes.
Yep, I did. Did you guys
did
know?
Did you know that kids who eat breakfast have higher GPAs?
Yeah, I know.
Okay. Yeah. That's actually what I was going to say.
Did you know babies should never touch silver? It's really bad for them.
I knew that.
Did you guys know that statistically friendly kids have more friends?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's obvious.
Did you know most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected.
I'm putting that on my blog.
I just put it in mine.
And best friends.
I love my sister.
My heart doesn't see race.
Love is love.
Our family is no less than any other family.
Love is kind. Love is patient.
Hello and welcome back to Open, everyone. Don't forget, we're always inviting you to get social with us at BronxNet TV. And while you're there, don't forget, tweet me too at Rena Valentin. So from April 20th to the 22nd, Hosto Center for the Arts and Culture presents Tito Puente, a 50-year retrospective of El Rey. This three-day event will comprise of concerts, discussions, and more, all in memory of the King of Latin Music. Joining us now to share more about the three-day event, please welcome Ana Martinez, newly appointed Vice President of Hosto Center, and John McElwee, Director of Hosto Center for the Arts and Culture. Hello and welcome.
Good morning.
Hello. Thank you for having us.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Hailing all the way from Florida?
Yes, see? Locura. Yes. Right from Miami into the winter of New York City. Back to New York after 30 years living in Miami. It's crazy.
Yeah, of course she would refer to it as locura because she transitioned in January. She's like, why couldn't it be in May?
What was I thinking?
It's like, Bob, welcome to New York.
But it's been great. It's been awesome. It's been an amazing ride.
So congratulations. So congratulations back. And welcome, welcome, welcome.
Thank you.
And I understand you're coming into a nice 50th anniversary celebration.
Yes.
Yes. This is getting old.
Yeah. Yes, which is perfect. It's in alignment with the Tito Puente 50th year retrospective. So I'm coming in a pivotal time where the college itself is just booming into its new 50 years, what the next 50 years are going to be like. And Tito Puente, and when I came in, I'm the VP of the Institutional Advancement Division at Hostos, and working with John, and he told me about the Tito Puente weekend, and I'm like, oh my God, what a wonderful, wonderful project, which is funded by the National Endowment of the Arts. And it's just, it's amazing. So I walked into what, you know, Hostos was already putting together.
And John, I'm sure you know all the details of what's going on that weekend, which sounds really promising for all generations. I just wanted to add that because I know you have like family time as well, which I thought was really awesome. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, it was just the NEA had an application open and gave it some thought. Hostos has a history with Tito Puente. We've got a lot of the memorabilia in our collection. We have some beautiful displays in the atrium. And Joe Conzo, who you know,
yeah,
runs
Joe Conzo
the
Senior. He does a lot of. He's actually kind of like
Tito, right? He's the Tito Puente class that mm-hmm. we've run for the last 6 years on Latin music, but it's sort of in honor of Tito Puente. So this sort of is the third piece to bring this all together and to put together a three-day festival and to have panel discussions, to have a film, and to have three concerts. One of them is for families on Saturday morning, Friday night on the 21st. Carlos Enriquez, a product of the Bronx, one of the great jazz musicians of New York right now. I'm a bass player, as you know, and he's one of the great bass players for Wynton Marsalis and so many more. And he's bringing a young group of lions together to perform Tito Puente's jazz, Latin jazz era. And then on the sort of the culminating event is on the 22nd, 7:30, and it's the Mambo Legends, who you probably know, I'm sure. And
how can you
I'm ready to dance.
And Cedar Rodriguez is sort of part of that, and so it's going to be fun. They are doing music that has not been heard in 50 years, and so these arrangements are all fresh for this particular performance. A lot of transcription that's going on, so it's really a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity if you like Tito Puente's music.
Not only that, I also really appreciate the fact that there's an introduction to the next generation, which is why I was referencing the family, because the next generation doesn't really know who Tito Puente is, and this is a three-day activity, right? So what happens on Thursday?
We have a film. There was a film that was done in 2000, and it's Tito Puente, the king of Latin music. And it's a really great documentary. It's got lots of cameos and discussions by artists that you recognize, you know, Mark Anthony and so many others that talk about Tito Puente's influence on Latin music and Latin jazz. And it sort of culminates with his performance at the Puerto Rico Symphony, which was a big, exciting thing for him to do. He had never done that before with them. And then he passed, you know, just shortly after, mm-hmm. a couple of weeks after that event. So. Anyway, Hostos actually did the debut of this film in 2000, so it's nice to show it again in 2017. And Joe Conzo Sr. and Bob Sancho, who you probably know, who is vice president of Bronx-Lebanon Hospital, are in the film, but after the film they're going to talk about Tito Puente the person. So then it goes on from there, and we have Friday night we have the concert with Carlos Enriquez. Joe Conzo is doing a warm-up lecture before that. And then on Saturday, it's 12 hours of programming. So it starts for a workshop at 10:30 for kids, 11:30 for a family concert. We've got a percussion clinic at 1:30, a panel discussion at 3:30.
A percussion clinic?
Yeah.
Jose Madera.
A percussion clinic. I like the term. I like the term. What is that for, like, quick fix percussion classes?
Well, it's just to learn some rudiments and nuances of those particular things. And it's really centered around the conga drums. The timbales and the bongos. Mm-hmm. And John Dandy Rodriguez, who's the bongo player of 35 years with Tito Puente, is probably one of the greatest bongo players on the planet. Mm-hmm. And so it's exciting. A lot of people want to come. Jose Madera doesn't do that many workshops, so people really want to hear him. And then Annette Aguilar, who you know, is also going to do some stuff on congas.
Nice.
So.
And the panel discussion is on, don't call it salsa, because you know Tito Puente was one of the promoters of that salsa. You shouldn't call it salsa. And so that should be interesting. One of our faculty actually teaches on Tito Puente. Tell me a little bit more about that, because I know that we teach a workshop on that.
Yeah, Joe Conza runs that class on Saturday mornings. Mm-hmm. And so he's going to, for this particular weekend, he's doing the sessions at 6 p.m.
I'm looking at some of the footage. What is this footage from?
That's Mario Rivera, and he was one of the great saxophonists. He's no longer living, unfortunately, but this is the band in its heyday, so really fantastic. But anyway, we have the 6 o'clock discussion with Joe Conzo, and then the performance at 7:30, and then in true Hosto style, we're going to have a dance mania to close the evening out. At 9:30.
It's like a nonstop party.
Right.
Saturday night event, you know, just come to Hostos. Yeah.
So you mentioned the NEA, and I love that you did, mm-hmm. because, you know, obviously it's important that we understand the importance of these foundations, mm-hmm. and the services that they provide. And I'm just curious, you know, like, what was the criteria that needed to be met, and how did it end up being Tito Puente?
Well, it was interesting, you know, that we've had the Tito Puente archives for some time, and we're looking to do something like Bon Planasso, which was over multiple days and had performances and films, and we had the audience for that kind of thing. We had never applied to the Jazz Division of National Endowment for the Arts. So I called there, and the director, Christoph Schutenbach, she said, Carlos Enriquez, I love Carlos Enriquez. He's the future of Latin music, and she was so excited. So she encouraged me to apply. And, you know, the Bronx is also a little bit underrepresented in the National Endowment for the Arts, so they look favorably on projects that are going to make an impact in this community. And anyway, very excited, so it's sort of a testament. We also get money from the Department of Cultural Affairs, which helps make this possible. But it's really fun, and people are going to be there, you know, for 12 hours on Saturday, and it'll be fun. And it's going to be a great experience for everyone.
Yeah, no, Hostos is doing some really great concerts. I'm enjoying being a part of them as well. Mm-hmm. And yes.
Yeah, it's a great balance between, you know, the Mambo legends, so the past and the present with Carlos Enriquez. I think, again, it's talking about what you just mentioned, is taking it to the future and teaching young kids about the future of this wonderful legend and his music.
Well, we have a lot of great musicians here in the Bronx, and then there's this whole movement of fusion, and it's important to know mm-hmm. the origins of this fusion music, right? As you're saying, don't call it salsa, right? Mm-hmm. Which originates from mambo, right? Mm-hmm. And then all of this originates from the folkloric music. So there's, and that's one of the things I really love about Hostos, is like we're keeping that knowledge in the next generation's faces.
Alive.
Yes,
yeah.
Alive, and we're educating them, and we're making sure that the history behind it is also retained as well.
Mm, absolutely.
Yeah, so welcome, Anna.
Thank you.
This sounds like it's going to be a party, so.
Yes, I'm ready. I'm ready to dance. I'm actually, I haven't yet sat in our theaters to listen to a concert, and we have two amazing theaters, and I am personally looking forward to being on those seats and just listening to this wonderful music. I am beyond impressed at the theaters that we have and the quality of the presentations we afford the community. So I'm personally excited because I love Tito Puente. I actually met him once, and he's just a remarkable artist.
Love it. Love the enthusiasm. Mm-hmm. Thank you for being here with us, sharing it with our viewers. Mm-hmm. And once again, the Tito Puente, a 50-year retrospective of El Rey, excuse me, will be taking place from April 20th through the 22nd, all happening at the Hostos Center for the Arts and Culture, located on 450 Grand Concourse in the Bronx. And for a full list of all the events we just mentioned, please visit hostos.cuny.edu/culturearts. All right, so we're taking a quick break, but there's more open when we return.
coming to you from our BronxNet studios. Four new shows highlighting some of the best of the Bronx has to offer. We sit down with political leaders on In the District and discuss local legislation, events, and issues. See how the community and business come together with The Bronx Now on BronxNet. Nosotros features leaders from a Latino community. Meet those who are moving to make a difference in public service, business, arts, and culture. Looking for new and exciting dining experiences? Then you'll want to savor the Bronx and try new restaurants and eateries that fill the borough with delicious dishes. We have it all, so experience the Bronx in new and fresh ways on BronxNet.
Hello and welcome back to Open. Our next guest is a Haitian-Canadian photographer whose latest exhibit, From Mobutu to Beyoncé, is being presented at the Bronx Documentary Center. The exhibit explores the cultural conversation between Africa and the West. And here now to share more about her exhibit, please welcome photographer Emily Rainier. Rainier, yes.
Rainier.
Yes.
Yeah,
Rainier.
Quite there.
Rainier.
No, yeah, that's good.
Well, welcome, Emily, and thank you for putting this politically, well, it's a politically undertoned exhibit, right?
Yes,
so
it is.
Let's talk a little bit about Mobutu.
Well, Mobutu was the former dictator of Congo DRC for almost 30 years. But he was well known because he's part of my project because he wore a leopard tuck, leopard hat. And it was a symbol of national unity in Congo, the hat of Mobutu. He always been portrayed almost with this hat. If you look at all the archives or the film, he always wear this hat. And the hat was saying, I'm the chief. I'm the chief of the Congo.
So, Mobutu to Beyoncé, how are they related?
Well, they're not related
or
at
not
all.
Right,
I made them related. They're related to the fact that in West Africa now, the project I did, this is two projects. The first project is the series about leopard, where I explore the symbolism and the power of leopard in Central Africa, Central and Southern Africa, where it's always been a symbol of power, and through how it the West made it like one of the biggest patterns in fashion, starting mainly with Dior in 1947. The other segment of the exhibition is a series I've done on hair in Ivory Coast in 2014. And this series show women wearing different haircut. And when I asked those women why they will do this hair choice, most of them told me is because I want to look like Beyoncé or because I want to look like Rihanna. So it's all come like through globalization and television and the internet. We all inter-influence each other. So this is why it's called From Mobutu to Beyoncé.
I have to sit with that for a minute because you're really referencing the power of influence.
Yes.
And it's very interesting. Did you do like a survey of some sort?
Well, not a survey in a sense of like, you mean a research?
Yes.
A deep research?
Yes.
Not really. For the leopard, I had to reach out to historian to do like archives, the archives research. Uh-huh. But there was not like a PhD.
No.
It's just more like, it's more conceptual.
Right. I'm really trying to figure how you related the two, even though they're unrelated. And we're looking at an image now, so I kind of can, I get the leopard influence in your work?
Yes.
Yes, yes. So let's talk a little bit about this.
About this image?
Yes.
Well, this young girl is a woman I photographed in a hair salon in Abidjan back in 2014. Mm-hmm. And you can see her hair. Like, when the woman say, I want to look like Beyoncé, the woman I photographed for this project, it also means, like, there is Beyoncé, but this is my interpretation of Beyoncé, which is very cultural. or linked to their own vision of aesthetic.
Mm-hmm. So are you just randomly capturing these ladies?
Somehow, yes.
Yes.
I went from market to market in different neighborhood of Abidjan, where I will meet, I will go to the hair salon, meet women, talk with them. Some will be hairdressers, some will be actually customer women that came to have their hair done.
So the, I guess the true underlying story here is hair.
Yes.
Yes.
For this project.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Okay. No. It's just I'm tying it all
yeah,
in together.
Yeah. It's kind of a travel in my own imaginary. You know, it's which real people, but how? What I'm interested is how everything goes around from leopards starting in Central and Austral Africa, and with Dior making it the most beautiful, most ennoblished pattern in fashion, and that being democratized with Cavalli, Dolce & Gabbana, H&M. But basically, leopard is the most powerful symbol of Africa, and hair starting with Afro-American pop star, but making his way back to Africa in a very different exchange too, in the way we interpret those exchange.
It's very fascinating.
Thank
it's very fascinating. What I guess brought you to this place of even really thinking about this so deeply?
Oh, well, for hair, at first I was, you know, I've been living in West Africa for many years. And one day I was in a hair salon and I was looking at the book of the woman. And, you know, when you live somewhere for a long time, there's a lot of things that you don't see anymore because you've been accustomed to it. And I look at this book and I was like, oh my God. Those haircuts are unbelievable. And then I start digging and I was like, okay, I want to do a project on that. I want to show what beauty represents for those women.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, it's beautiful because you definitely captured art. And that's all I see in your images. It's just the art. And I'm seeing even in the women doing their hairs and they're walking around like pieces of art.
Yes, and there's always been a tradition for women and hair in Africa, much before the wigs and the extension. If you look at the work of the Nigerian photographer Okai Okajiri, like the women have those amazing structure, and or in the even the braiding, and the braiding have its history. There's a symbol. There was something to say something about your own self, the way you will do your hair. And I feel that even in more contemporary times, with the reference of Mobutu Ariana, they still say something about themselves that is really deep.
Nice. And so how long are you on exhibit at the Bronx Documentary Center?
Well, the show is starting this Saturday at 6 p.m. and is going to be going through until June 4.
Okay, so there's a reception, there's an opening reception happening this Saturday?
Yes.
At 6 p.m.?
Sure.
And we congratulate you.
Thank you.
On basically just empowering all of us to just be who you want to be and just express yourself fully, in especially with different types of hair, right?
Yes, sure.
And you're also, I'm. This is what I interpreted from your images. You're also saying that hair almost can identify people's origins or like their regions or where they reside.
Yeah, well, yes, it
yeah,
is.
Yeah, right?
Totally.
Yeah.
I mean, those photos were taken in Abidjan, but if you go to different region of Ivory Coast, like on the border with Liberia, or you won't have the same hairstyle. Women won't wear the same hairstyle.
Fascinating.
So,
that's yeah. Something really for all of us to think about. I never thought about that. Thank you for sharing that. All right.
Thank you,
guys.
Yeah.
Actually, you can experience it from Mobutu to Beyonce. It's actually going to be an exhibit from April 15th through June 4th with the opening reception on April 15th from 6 to 9 p.m. And that's all happening at the Bronx Documentary Center located at 614 Cortland Avenue at 151st Street in the Bronx. For more information, visit bronxdoc.org. Thank you.
Thank you, Ria.
All right. Once again, we're taking a break, but don't go anywhere. Bobby C's weekly sports roundup is coming up next.
This is Bobby C. out at Yankee Stadium. It was a perfect day for the return of baseball here in the Bronx, and a near perfect day for Yankee starter Michael Pineda. Pineda talked about how in sync he was with his battery mate.
I know Roman from a couple years ago. We stayed together, and he know me, and I know him. And we worked in like same pace today, and we had a good plan, and we used it.
He wanted to stay aggressive, and you know, you got to give him credit for that. It was the most composed that I've seen him on the mound in a long time. It was very smooth, and there was no like over urgency for anything. There wasn't a lot of movement going on. It was ball on the mound, and execute a pitch, and you know, he made a lot of really good pitches.
And although the Baby Bombers have been injured, there was still Aaron Judge, who homered for the second straight game.
We miss Gary and Bray. Those are two, three hitters, three, four hitters. Man, they're middle of the lineup guys. You know, anytime you're on the lineup, you know, it's tough. But the guys we got on this team, man, they're doing their part. You know, they're doing their part to fill the holes. And, you know, we just got to keep this little thing rolling right now.
We can win games in a lot of different ways. We got some guys that are capable of doing some different things up and down the lineup. And, you know, you can't always win with a 3- and 4-run homer, 2-run homer. I mean, there's going to be days when you're facing a tough pitcher, as we were today, and you got to try and do things to manufacture runs. And thank goodness for Big Mike. We didn't need to score a bunch, but, you know, I thought it was a great day.
We begin our look at your Gotham sports on the diamond, where the Yankees and the Mets have turned the corner in the early season and are playing superb baseball. The Bronx Bombers opened the campaign 2-4 on the road, but have since gone 3-0 since coming home to the Bronx. Tampa Bay has been the right remedy for the Yanks. Aaron Judge is carrying the Baby Bombers with injuries to Greg Bird and Gary Sanchez. The biggest Baby Bomber of them all has started to live up to the tall promise the organization believes is in store for him. The Pinstripers had an off day Tuesday, but returned in an 8-4 victory on Wednesday, where new fifth starter Jordan Montgomery, my pick during spring training for the spot and apparently the Yanks' choice as well, looked plenty more poised than your average 24-year-old making his major league debut. The 6'6" left-hander went 4 2/3, allowing 2 earned runs while striking out 7. Here's more with Jordan and Yanks GM Brian Cashman.
I had so much downtime this morning, kind of killed me. I was a little nervous sitting around. I got here early so I could settle in, but once I started getting in my routine, nerves kind of went away, and then I kind of got locked in.
Thought it was great. You know, I don't think there was any nerves. He, you know, complete strike thrower, and you know, made one bad pitch, and I thought he did a tremendous job. So continuation of what we saw in spring training, a lot of poise, you know, a lot of pitchability, and so it looks like somebody hopefully you know, could help us for quite some time.
It was a good outing. Could have been worse. Could have been better. We won as a team, so I mean, that's all you really can do. Would like to go 5, 6, 7 innings next time, but team won, so can't complain about it.
For good measure, the Yankees swept the Rays on Thursday night. It was Aaron Hicks's turn to be the star Aaron for an evening. He homered twice, Yankees 3, Rays 2. That's 4 straight wins for the Bombers, who are now 5-4 through the first 9 games. The Yanks welcome St. Louis to the big ballpark in the Bronx for a weekend interleague series. What's better than a 4-game win streak? How about 5 in a row, a 5-game win streak. The New York Mets have won 5 straight. Travis d'Arnaud led off the 16th inning with a home run, giving him a career-high 4 hits, and the Amazons beat the Miami Marlins 9-8 Thursday night. The win comes after sweeping the Philadelphia Phillies earlier in the week. The 7-3 Mets will cap the weekend with 3 more games in Miami. Yoenis Cespedes has 6 home runs this season, including 2 on Thursday night and 3 in 1 game earlier this week, and Fuego for Cespedes. Time for some quick hitters from around the world of sports. Only bad news for the Yanks this week was word that 23-year-old budding ace James Kaprielian would be lost to Tommy John surgery. Big blow to the Yanks farm system. Yanks will have to wait for him to make his way back from surgery and rehab. The NFL draft is at the end of this month. Rumblings that the Jets could go out and nab tight end O.J. Howard out of Alabama. Meanwhile, the Giants are searching for Plan B, with Jonathan Hankins signing with the Indianapolis Colts. Perhaps the G-men will explore signing a defensive tackle in the NFL draft. A 2010 email from Eli Manning to a Giants equipment manager asked for 2 helmets that can be passed off as game used, according to documents filed Tuesday in Bergen County Superior Court. Manning is being accused of memorabilia fraud. Pittsburgh Steelers chairman Dan Rooney has passed away at the age of 84. He was an influential NFL figure for decades. In Dallas, Dirk Nowitzki will be back to play in the association next season. 2017-18 will be his 20th in the NBA. Former Dallas Cowboys quarterback Tony Romo has had plenty of fun with Mavs owner Mark Cuban, at the tail end of the NBA season. NBA Commissioner Adam Silver shot down a request by Cuban to suit up Romo, but that didn't stop fans in Dallas from buying up all of the Mavs Romo jerseys. They were sold out by the end of the first quarter during a recent game. Romo is ditching football and basketball to be the new football voice on CBS. He replaces former Giants quarterback Phil Simms in that role. The NBA season is over in New York, at least for Knicks and Nets fans. Carmelo Anthony scored 17 points after deciding to play in what could be his final game with the Knicks. And New York beat the Philadelphia 76ers 114-113 on Wednesday night. A disappointing and at times tumultuous season has ended. Now the offseason drama could include a mellow trade. Where do Phil Jackson and company go from here is the big question. Jimmy Butler scored 25 points and the Chicago Bulls beat the depleted Brooklyn Nets 112-73 in the regular season finale to clinch an Eastern Conference playoff spot on Wednesday. NBA fans get a great first round playoff matchup of MVP candidates as OKC and Houston square off. That means plenty of Russell Westbrook and James Harden in the West. Golden State is the top seed in the East. It's Boston who may very well get that number one pick in the draft courtesy of the Nets. The Seas only care about taking down the second-seeded Cavaliers. Cleveland, of course, not only the reigning champ of the East, but also the reigning champ of the NBA. The finals begin June 1st. I wouldn't say I'm sold on the New York Rangers' chances of winning the Stanley Cup this year, at least in comparison to some of the teams they have had over the past five seasons, and that includes a trip to the Cup Finals. But the last week has showed some signs of promise. The Rangers capped the regular season with a win over Pittsburgh and then went out and played arguably their best game all year. Henrik Lundqvist made 31 saves to help the Broadway Blue Shirts beat the Canadiens 2-0 on Wednesday night in Game 1 of their first round playoff series. Game 2 is tonight in Montreal. The Rangers will be back at the Garden for Game 3 on Easter Sunday and then Game 4 on Tuesday night at the world's most famous arena. In MLS soccer, NYCFC fell to DC United 2-1 last time out. They have Philadelphia tonight at 7 p.m. The Red Bulls are in action against DC United on Saturday. On the links, Sergio Garcia is your 2017 Masters champion. He got past Justin Rose at Augusta. Big news for motorsport fans, F1 star Fernando Alonso will drive in the 101st Indianapolis 500. Fellow F1 star Lewis Hamilton says Alonso is the best in the field for the 500. Now he'll have to go out there and prove it. The endurance race isn't just about being the best. It's also about some luck and some strategy. Just ask Alexander Rossi, who won it last year as a rookie. In MotoGP, Jorge Lorenzo is off to a poor start in his debut season with Ducati. He finished 11th at Qatar and followed that up with some more trouble in the Argentine Grand Prix, where he finished 23rd. The champion will look to get back on track in the Grand Prix of Americas on April 23rd. Those are the headlines. We hit the C-list for a note on Aaron Judge. Folks, the time has come. It seems like the arrival is perhaps even a little earlier than expected. Aaron Judge is just 24 years old, but his raw talent seemed to be something that could take another year or two to blossom. Our BronxNet cameras captured Judge when he became the 32nd pick in the first-year player draft in 2013. I remember standing there at the MLB studios looking up at Aaron Judge the way we were on opening day, thinking, if this guy hits like the Hercules he looks like, the Bronx Bombers have found a slugger that could rival any of the big boppers in the game today. He reminds me of Giancarlo Stanton. Judge is 6'7", 230 pounds. The knock on him is contact. He batted 179 in limited time last year. He's batting 276 to date this season. The organization and fans will sign up for that, especially since he has 3 homers in 9 games and is starting to be the feared hitter the Pinstripers believe he could be. I envision number 99 batting cleanup or fifth at some point in this lineup. Judge, Sanchez, and Bird will comprise the middle of the order, the new core for the Yankees. Are you sold on the early season success of Aaron? I'll let you be the judge. Chime in on social media and let us know what you think of Aaron Judge. I think he'll hit 25 to 30 homers this season, his first full year in the majors. That's your sports. I'm Bobby C.
Coming to you from our BronxNet studios, 4 new shows highlighting some of the best of the Bronx has to offer.
sit down with political leaders on In the District and discuss local legislation, events, and issues. See how the community and business come together with The Bronx Now on BronxNet. Nosotros features leaders from a Latino community. Meet those who are moving to make a difference in public service, business, arts, and culture. Looking for new and exciting dining experiences? Then you'll want to savor the Bronx and try new restaurants and eateries that fill the borough with delicious dishes. We have it all, so experience the Bronx in new and fresh ways on BronxNet.
Hamilton was adopted from a rescue in 2008. He really likes to be around people. And as soon as I start to make my breakfast, Hamilton is right there. I get out my mat and I'm doing a downward dog and he's underneath. He's quite the pug about town. He gets invited to a lot of parties. He knows he's a pretty big deal. I mean, look at this little face. How could you not love him?
Welcome back to Open, everyone. It's now time for this week's Open Artist Spotlight.
The Open Artist Spotlight is made possible in part with public funds from the Bronx Council on the Arts through the New York State Council on the Arts Decentralization Program.
Our Open Artist Spotlight this week shines on the dancers of Mad About Dance Company. Their upcoming show, Creative Collision, choreographed by director of the company, Michio Tanaka, will be formed at Bronx Community College. And today, they're going to give us a taste. Performing an excerpt from Creative Collision on the Open Artist stage, please welcome the popular Mad About Dance Company.
Thank you.
Woo! Wow. Wow. Wow, I don't even know what to walk into. I'm like, wow, Mad About Dance Company. Nice. Nice. Oh, yes, let's. I got caught up in that, right? And this is Michio, the choreographer. Yeah. And Mal, the assistant choreographer, right?
Yes. No, he's the resident choreographer and assistant director.
Okay, so a resident choreographer, assistant director.
Yes.
Nice. Amazing. Amazing. Thank you. Let's just talk a little bit about this piece.
Okay.
It kind of is related to society right now.
Yes.
Yes. I mean, of course, it's all about interpretation, but I just want to know what inspired it.
Okay. I also teach art history at Bronx Community College, and I really love Vincent Van Gogh. And I started thinking about how he must have felt in his turmoil in life, and what night vision, this is the title of it, and what he was going through mentally. And as you said, a lot of people are going through this turmoil right now. And so we kind of made it into a modern day.
Yeah, it's very interesting how we're all holding hands right now.
Yeah, I love it.
I just realized that. I'm like, oh, we haven't let go. And so I'm just sharing that because there's a need to kind of come together and come to terms with the fact that as a society, and I don't necessarily know if that's what inspired the piece, but there's a mental health issue.
Yes, yeah. There is.
And of course, this piece loans itself to just even the negativity and the phrasing and the words, and I'm still speechless over what I experienced, not in just watching it, and how I felt watching it.
Okay.
And so, do you want to say something to that?
It's definitely like an intense piece, but it definitely speaks, and I think that the audience will get it. It will come across very clear.
So what else should we expect in this presentation?
Well, we also have a guest performers this time, and it's funny because my young dancers call them OGs. I thought it meant old geriatrics, and I didn't know that it meant, what was it?
The
original gangsta.
Original gangsta.
I used to originally teach at Lehman. I taught dance and theater. And there are some alumni that were in my company at the time. So the three of the dancers are going to be performing with us. And so he's choreographing this really hot number with them and the company.
He looks fabulous.
Doesn't he look
great? I was going, I'm like, yeah, I could totally see him being really hot.
And he's a beautiful dancer too. So, and he'll be doing a solo.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for sharing it with our viewers. Also, we did want to mention that the presentation is free, right?
Yes,
so
free.
Everybody's welcome. Everybody's welcome. And once again, Mad About Dance Company will be performing a Creative Collision on Thursday, April 20th and Friday, April 21st at Bronx Community College, West 181st Street and University Avenue in the Bronx. And for more information, you can call 914-734-8410. That is our show today, mi gente. Thanks to all our guests for coming through. And to you, our viewers, for tuning in. If you missed any part of the show, you can check out the Retablecast tonight in 24 hours a day at BronxNet.tv. I'm Rena Valentin. And from all of us here at Open, may the universe provide peace, prosperity, y amor. Mwah. Adios, everybody. Thank you, Mad About Dance.